reporting on the games you love by people who love to game. The MMO Reporter Network.
You're logging into your favorite game, grinding out some gear. A couple of points added to your stats, and you have a virtual beer. Max level is pretty cool, but I'll remind you here, my friend. These games are not about the goal, it's about the journey and not the end.
You're listening to MMO Reporter on the MMO Reporter Network, brought to you by Doghouse Systems. Choose your weapons with Doghouse Systems. Audible, find your next great read at audibletrial.com/MMOReporter, and by GoDaddy. Put your website to work while you play.
Don't forget about your alts you need to cherish. Each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your alts you need.
Hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of MMO Reporter. This is episode 206. 206 shows. Bill, who would have thunk it? Really?
Oh, not me. I'm amazed we made it past five.
Double digits was a big deal to me.
Yeah. For me, because I can't count that high. I'd need an extra finger to get there.
Well, and then you can use my finger. Off. No, we're good.
I know which one too.
we're good, Leonor. You don't need to talk about your
fingers.
Okay. Yeah. Especially when you have issues with pants.
Only time I get to use it.
Moving on, because we have got lots to talk about, and some really cool news from our Patreon campaign. I'm really excited to talk about that, and we've got people here in the chat room to share with us. Let's get right to what we've been playing, though, because we do have to talk about that, because it's kind of awesome. Some people say it's even the favorite part of the show for them, what we've done in-game this week. It's kind of interesting. Leonor, why don't you start?
Well, I did a little bit of LOTRO over the week. Did some epic battles, and just did some with Carrie from LOTRO Reporter, and she got some new jewelry for the first time out of those.
Nice.
So that was kind of cool. Got back into Landmark for a little bit, even live streamed it to kind of look at what they updated. And unfortunately, since the game is still in beta, I was getting a lot of crashes, and I actually got stuck in a hole.
a diggy diggy hole,
yes.
So
I didn't find anything what's that?
A hole that somebody diggy diggied, obviously. So with Landmark, are you getting at all nervous about the whole Daybreak ownership schmozzle? Because I've been starting to, we don't have it in the news, but we'll plug it in here. I'm starting to see people starting to get more and more concerned that Landmark and or EverQuest Next are not actually going to make it.
Well, I'm kind of thinking that, Landmark, I'm pretty sure, is going to be continuing. They actually seem like they have quite a bit done in the game. And even though the game is kind of crashing and a little bit weird at times, it's actually come quite a far, quite far from where they were before. The game actually feels a lot nicer than the last time that I played it. I didn't get to see a lot of the other things that I wanted to, like combat and stuff like that, but it does seem to have a lot more polish to it. And people were making even more intricate things than they were before. So they've been doing a lot of work on that, and it shows. Mm-hmm. EverQuest Next, I have no idea. All I've seen is, you know, just what everybody else has seen, the trailers. And I know that they've been working on that for a while, and that's pretty much all I know. So that's why I was thinking last week that the company is probably going to be forced to either rush that game or probably cancel.
Okay, so let's focus, because you were in Landmark and we talked about having you jump in there. Are you able to have a quality experience in there that's not focused around building? Because they've always said that it's going to be a full MMO. You just happen to also be able to build in it.
Right.
So can you have that experience
yet? I did not see any of that kind of stuff yet.
Okay.
There's no leveling experience or anything that I could tell that there was there. Not even a section on your character sheet that showed what level you are. I don't think I've seen anything like that. And without finding any monsters or anything to kill too was another thing. I could not experience that properly. I think I have to gather a lot of materials, build a lot of things, get a bunch of gear, and then go into the harder, more lower level depth stuff. And that's maybe when I'll find some combat, but I don't know.
Well, I know it's pretty hard to get down to the lower depths because I dug for an hour and a half one night and I didn't get anywhere.
Well, this is a little bit different. They have a crystal system where you have to get a bunch of crystals and you get gear and stuff, and you need all of the extra gear to get even more crystals. And when you have all these crystals, you can travel to a lower plane through the main temple area. I can't remember the name, the spire. So, and there's six different levels of difficulty.
Okay.
So that's what you need to do, that you need to gather a whole bunch of stuff and then go to the next difficulty. The next difficulty area has different materials, different gems, different types of wood, and okay. Then you keep going and going and going, and you keep getting better stuff and all that. So I'm assuming the combat happens on those lower levels instead of the beginner area.
So if, based on what you've seen so far, and I realize how limited this is, so I am asking you to extrapolate quite a bit, do you think it would be viable for someone like me who is not a builder? I'm not into building stuff. I like to see what other people have built, but I just don't see things like that. I'm not a carver. I'm not a painter. I can't create something like that. And will I be able to go into the game and spend my experience gathering stuff for everyone else? And I know they're going to have some sort of marketplace, but could that be my game experience? Can you extrapolate on what you've seen so far to see whether or not that would be viable?
If they actually had some sort of an auction hall or some sort of trading thing going on, then yes, definitely you'd be able to go in and just go ahead and do that kind of stuff.
Cool.
But right now, yeah, it is pretty much a gathering game and a building game as far as I can tell.
Okay. Well, it seems interesting. What else did you play?
Let's see. I'm looking at the wrong sheet. There is a game that I wanted to try because I went over into Milwaukee and I was in a hotel room for a while. And I went to go see the Milwaukee Museum, by the way. Or not the museum, the zoo. It was pretty cool. All the animals are out there in the winter. It's kind of strange.
Huh.
The penguins looked pretty hot outside.
If they were in their natural habitats, they'd be staying in their condos for the winter.
So I was on my tablet and looking for some MMOs on my tablet, and there was a game called Order and Chaos. And it was something that was kind of highly rated, and I just kind of popped onto it and took a look at it. And holy cow, does this look like a World of Warcraft clone in art style. They have, like, undead, which are the exact same, like, style as the undead. They're kind of hunched over, and their arms hang, and they're all either greenish or purplish. I mean, it's, like, exact. They have orcs. They have elves. You can make the elves either look like blood elves or night elves. Humans. No cows, though, surprisingly enough.
Well, then I can't be a holy cow. What's the point, then?
So I got into the starter area, and I ended up having to turn it off not long after, but I got into the starting area, and it was just crowded. And I was kind of surprised by that because I had never even heard of this game before. So I'm hoping to check that out a little bit more during the week.
This okay. I'm just looking at screenshots right now. This reminds me of those amazingly blatant knockoff games that you get in like the Google Play Store that are just like be called World of Blarcraft or something like that. It's just completely obviously ripping off other games. And yeah, I mean the UI is different, and I can see how the buttons are in different places and everything, so that's different. But yeah, the art style, the character blockiness, the shape of the orcs and everything like that. I mean, not that obviously not that World of Warcraft is the pioneers of character models or anything like that, but having played WoW, that's the similarities are like that's. It almost looks like it's like a beta build of World of Warcraft, or it could be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm showing it right now to the live stream, and it totally looks like, you know, early 2003 Warcraft.
Mm-hmm.
Right? It's kind of textured the same way, and
like there's a couple of screenshots here of buildings and that kind of thing too that look exactly like human cottages in World of Warcraft. Like I like
your title though, World of Blarcraft.
I know
we should need to make that game.
no G, just Blarcraft.
Blarcraft.
We should make that game. I bet you it would be awesome.
We could just put it on the Google Play Store and we'd be rich. Mm-hmm.
Well,
what
we could do is we'll sit down, we'll record an hour of World of Warcraft dungeon running or whatever, just mm-hmm. screen cap it, and we'll add like ads and hyperlinks to it and put it on the Play Store and call it World of Blarcraft and sell it. We'll sell it for $1, rake in that fat ad money.
Right. You've got a plan here. I do believe this is the business plan of 90% of the games on Google Play. This should not be live on the stream.
Someone's going to copy this.
Yeah.
The only problem
is going to copy this copy.
The only problem is I'll never be able to sleep again.
Yeah.
Holy cow. Look at the... Okay, I'm going to...
There's no holy
cow. Quickly share a screenshot here of an orc mining.
Yeah.
Pardon me. We're doing this the old-fashioned.
You're following this, well, Chris... school of audio production.
Yeah. No
pauses, right?
Just pausing, you know, like keeping talking really awkwardly so that I can make people believe.
While
that
you're
I'm
doing that,
actually...
let me say something else real quick. That this was on a top 10 list of MMOs for Android, and this was the top one, and it's apparently the biggest and largest world that you can get into for a free to play game on Android. So I was like, wow. It's kind of neat. And then, you know, all the comments right underneath it are, of course, looks exactly like World of Warcraft. And it's just, okay, I'll download it and I'll check it out.
Now you can say you've played WoW, almost.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go, yeah. So when we start talking about WoW dungeon runs, just talk about what you did in Order and Chaos and that. But you see the screenshot I sent you there, Chris?
Yeah, I'm pulling it up now.
It's...
Yeah.
Anyway, that's interesting. It makes me sad. I think it sadly delegitimizes the Google Play Store when this kind of stuff goes there, like very obvious crapware.
Yeah, but you and say Google back, Play like it doesn't happen on iTunes too.
Well, I know my experience. I'm not an i guy, so I assume it's the same on iOS. But I mean, this goes really back to. I mean, if you think about the games industry back in the early 80s when Atari was just booming and there was a mad rush on people just barfing out the worst games ever with no quality control or anything like that, it sort of feels like that's what's happening on the Google Play Store.
Five Nights at Freddy's 2.
Yeah.
Hey.
Sorry, what?
Some of those are good.
But, I mean... Yeah. Sadly, and I mean, this is my old man whining about what the kids are doing with the Play Store and everything like that. It sort of feels like what it is, and the way it is now. And I know as an Android guy, I've got two Android devices that are with me everywhere I go. I don't even like shopping for games on the Play Store because I feel like my success rate is going to be like maybe 5%. I'm going to have to buy 20 games before I find one that's good. And that makes me sad.
Aw, poor Belle. All right, Leonor, you got one more?
Yes, I got one more.
One more.
It's not what I played, but what I found out. And this is dealing with World of Warcraft. I've never had a World of Warcraft account. I've never paid for one through Battle.net or anything like that. But for some reason, while I was at the hotel, I purchased the expansion. It showed up in my email. I'm like, what the heck? And then the next morning, it went through that they could not confirm that I bought the expansion. and that I should check my information just in case my account is hacked. And I tried to sign into BattleNet after coming back from Milwaukee, and my email or my password was changed.
Oh.
Oh, no.
So, well, the only thing that they would be able to get access to would be my Hearthstone account, where I've never even used a credit card or anything on anyway.
But they bought you the expansion?
I did not get the expansion because I don't even have the game.
So it sounds like somebody was just trying to game your account by buying it and then, like, returning it instantly and doing a password reset in order to fix it or something.
Something like that, yeah. But I was able to recover my account and everything. So, but yeah, that was really strange. I don't know if it was just something that somebody found something on Wi-Fi while I was at the hotel or what. But it was a bit strange.
Weird.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Dual factor authentication. All right, Bill. You're up.
Oh, well. Speaking of sad stories, as some of you might have known, I was a little bit ill last week, and when I say a little bit, I mean violently and horribly and disgustingly ill for the whole week. And I'd had a really good run of playing Elite Dangerous every week and was really enjoying it. And I'd broken a million credits for the first time, and I was feeling quite high on myself. And I had last week, I was all lined up. I had great stories about lessons learned playing Elite Dangerous and that. So I won't go too deep into that, but I tried to play Elite Dangerous while I was sick, and it made me sicker.
Oh, really?
Oh, it was just the whole motion and the stars flying by and everything. It made me ill, and I'm better now, and it's not hurting me, but I really honestly tried to play Elite Dangerous. Not good when you got a stomach flu. Just speaking of lessons learned. Yeah. Just if you're going to play Elite while you're sick, then just keep a bucket nearby. So,
wow.
So hey, actually, you know what? I am going to regale my Elite Dangerous story here because it's a good one, and okay. I think it's something that's valuable.
And then I want to say something about Elite Dangerous because I have some exciting news.
Oh, yes, you have a story. I know about this story. Anyway, so my story. I'm cruising around, and I've got a mission in Elite Dangerous to be hunting pirates. So I'm looking to interdict people with wanted tags in Federation space, which means that the only people that you can interdict and attack are actual criminals. So that made it a little bit easier. So I'm cruising along, doing my thing. I took down one really good pirate. I was able to get a really good bounty off of him, advance my quest or the mission, whatever you want to call it, and also pick up some sweet stolen goods. It's like smuggled goods. So like I was sitting on probably 50 grand worth of stolen goods and I was sitting on easily 200 grand worth of bounties between all the various factions and everything like that. Anyway, long and short, sitting really pretty. Starting to fly back to the space station and I get interdicted. Bang, ripped out of space, and I'll fight my way out of this. I've taken out everything that's come at me so far. Turn around and it's a friggin' python. Now, for those of you that don't know Elite Dangerous, the ship that I fly in is a Cobra, which is roughly a 250,000 credit ship. Nice ship, fast and everything like that. The Python is a 30 million credit ship that has enough guns to vaporize me in less than a second. So I'm like, ah. Crap. Okay, so I see this thing and I just go into absolute bug out mode, and so I'm firing up my frameshift drive and I'm going as fast as I can, and this thing is just tearing me a new one. It's my shields are down in just a couple split seconds, and by the time my shields were down and I was down like 20% hull in no time before I finally was able to boost out of weapons range, but I did make it into frameshift, so I'm like, oh yes. Good. Okay, so I'm just going to go limp into base, sell my stuff, collect my bounties, and we'll just chalk this up to victory. I am literally 30 seconds from landing at a space station, and I get interdicted again. I'm not done. Interdicted again, but this time it's a Viper. A Viper for those of you that don't know, is half the size of a Cobra, but a little bit faster, but also has much smaller weapon points. So I'm angry now. I'm like, oh, how dare you? I'm going to end you right now. The little bugger hits me with a missile right off. My shields are down to nothing. And he pings me with like four little machine gun blasts, just dink, 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 dink. My hull went down 1%, but my cabin pressure went to nothing. Oh, dang it. So now I've got to escape this ship that's faster than me to try to get back into space. And I've only got 5 minutes. So I'm dodging and weaving and trying to get away from this guy so I can land and get myself prepared. And in the meantime, oxygen is leaking. It's leaking. It's leaking. And oh, no. So I finally get away. And I make it to the space to the space station, and I have 30 seconds of air left, and I'm 9 kilometers away from the space station, and I boost, and I give myself every last bit of power that I can possibly give myself, and my ship exploded while I was staring at the landing bay.
Oh,
not even,
no.
Not, like, if I'd had 5 more seconds, I would have landed and been safe.
No.
So, unfortunately... At the time that all this is happening.
Wait, yeah. What's that? Hello, from the field, we have a special report from our special field correspondent. Harry, are you there, Harry?
I am actually there. I'm currently tugging my luggage through Schiphol Airport, and I'm going to find my flight. Harry. To Boston, because that's what we're going to.
We sent you to PAX, Harry. We did it.
We did. Yes, actually, you did. And I'm. The proof is that I'm now desperately, frantically looking for a sign. Where is the sign? The sign is flights and arrivals. Now, I don't need arrivals. I need to leave this place. Wait. So, okay, look, walking to the other side. Yes, ask me a question.
Before you get through security and they strip search you and body cavity search you, just one quick comment I wanted to make. First of all, were you not impressed that I was able to figure out how to fire my guns all on my own in Elite Dangerous without any help from anyone whatsoever?
I've thought of little else, I can tell you that. And at the moment, I think that is the most important thing ever. It's not at all important that I have no idea where my flight's going to leave from. The only thing in my mind, Chris, is, and I, okay, you almost got me to shout in the hall of an airport about firing guns. I'm not.
Ladies and gentlemen, this will now be a solo coverage of PAX East, as Harry Hall is currently locked up in an undisclosed location.
There are some security people looking at me quite suspiciously. Guys, I gotta go.
Hey, have a good flight, Harry. See you in a few days in Boston.
See you then.
Travel safe.
This is Harry Hall out.
Okay, that was kind of awesome.
Now we will see Harry Hall in the sequel of Papers, Please 2.
Harold and Kumar don't go to Boston.
realistic graphics. Yeah.
Anyways. Yeah, so, sorry.
Long and short, the lesson there is I didn't have enough money to rebuy my ship, and I was really sad.
That's really sad.
Always have enough to cover your insurance.
But you want to know something that will make you happy?
What, you fired your guns?
I not only did I fire my guns, but I made Harry get a bounty, and not through killing me. I'm like, oh, look, I can fire my guns at this random. Oh, shoot, he's not a pirate. Harry, help me! And so now Harry was a pirate, and he got a bounty on his head.
Oh.
Yeah, it was all sorts of awesome. So I can fire my guns at Elite Dangerous. Oh my god, it's awesome.
It's a good thing that you admitted that he was a pirate after he got off the phone, because, you know, there's a... that he would have been on a list somehow.
How very, very true. All right, what else have you been doing?
Anyway, so the game that wasn't making me ill while I was already ill was actually Guild Wars 2, and I did a whole bunch of alting and running up crafting levels and just generally enjoying Guild Wars 2. And I just enjoy Guild Wars 2. I think I've said it before, But there's hardly any MMOs out there that are just that fun to play. Really enjoy it. Anyway, so I've got, I think I've got all my alts up in the 50-ish areas now and everything. So really enjoyed that. Well, I was in my time when I was needing to refract from 3D graphics and everything like that, and that, I did a bunch of reading and found actually a couple of little alt. I was hoping Harry was going to be on the show today, but I found a couple little alternate event timers for Guild Wars 2, which we'll put in the show notes here. But one's at silversunshine.net, and one's by the Guild Wars 2 personal assistant online, which is actually more of an overlay, but they're actually cool because you can actually interact with them and tick off the daily boss events or the world boss events that you've completed, so that as the events cycle through during the day, you know which one you've already completed, you know which one you're not going to get the bonus gear for or anything like that. So it was very cool. Nice. I liked it, and it saves you having to write it down, so we'll have those links for you. And the other one that I fired up finally is the Telltale Games Game of Thrones series, because I'm just itching for a new season of Game of Thrones. And this is going to hopefully keep me sane until April when it starts up again. So.
There was a story. I'll try and find it and throw it into the show notes. I don't know if I can, but it was on, I found it through my Feedly stuff, that was basically the premise. It was an editorial. The premise of said editorial was that none of the choices in Telltale Games matter.
Really?
Well, that's not true.
Yep, that in the end, you either delay an inevitable, and the same thing happens anyway, and the things that, you know, you hear, Clementine will remember this. Well, it never comes back. Apparently. I haven't played. I own all of season one of Walking Dead. I've played maybe an episode or two, so I can't be an expert. But I thought it was a really interesting premise, because that's what they've built their whole stuff around, right? Is that things matter?
Well, I wouldn't go as far as to say that. I'd be disappointed if that was actually the case, but I don't think it's the end of the world, because they hang their hat on telling the story. And they tell a story better than almost every game out there. So even if it is a linear story, I still think that's okay. That even if you are kind of on rails, the fact that you wouldn't be able to, your choices don't really matter, or that they don't affect the story or anything like that, that would be disappointing for replayability, I think. But I have to actually finish a Telltale game first. In order to
that's important.
Have that be an issue for me.
That's important. All right. I'm going to move things on. I have, it sounds like you're done, Bill.
Yes.
So I played some WoW. Just doing some more dungeons, trying to get the quests done for my garrison, and basically having a lot of fun. I'm now like nearly 630 gear rated. And so item leveled. So I'm doing pretty good there. And a lot of that has come through my missions, but some of it has also come through crafting. Some of it has come through. I love the fact that this is the perfect time right now for anyone to get into WoW who doesn't have a decked out character and who wants to, you know, get their crafting up, get their item level stuff up, be able to run all the content and get their character up. Now's the time, because through the garrison, they've got quests for all of your crafting professions, which give you bonus guaranteed skill item level point or skill level points, right? And it's just, I was thinking that the other day, this is just the perfect time for someone to come in. All right, played some Dragon Age Inquisition. I'm at like 50 hours now, and I'm really, really enjoying it, but I've had to. The grind is the wrong word, because I don't find any of it grindy, but I've had to go out and do some of the side quests to get enough power to finish off the next chunk of the story quests, because you have to you build up power through finishing side quests, and the next story chunk requires 40 power, so I've been building that up. And last but not least, played some Neverwinter with Harry, and I am always impressed when I'm playing how much I love the game and what fun it is, and just I think, oh, I need to be, we need to start a show about Neverwinter. Like, there needs to, every time I'm playing, I'm like, yeah. And then I stop playing, and I'm like, well, do I want to go back and play it again? Eh, maybe. Right? It's funny that I'm so into it while I'm playing it, but once I'm out of the game, its charm, it's not that it loses its charm, it's just that it doesn't have that strength of charm as it does when I'm actually actively playing it. Mm-hmm. Is that weird, or am I just weird?
I think it's really, I mean, it's a combination of it being a good game, but not like a blow the doors off great game.
Yeah.
And the fact that I never know anybody online, for me anyway. Like, there's no people to really draw me back to it. Like, anytime that I've ever felt the urge to play Neverwinter, I've had to cast around and never really found anybody who was super keen on it. So it's going through the hassle of trying to figure out who I want to play with. Do I want to meet somebody new tonight? No, I'm an introvert. Blech. So that's not a knock against Neverwinter. I feel like I'm actually missing out on a good gaming experience because it's a game that needs people. Like, I don't think I've tried playing it solo, and it's only very meh solo. In a group, it winds up being like, it's exponentially more fun when you're with more people in Neverwinter. So
yeah,
if you've got a group,
it does have a great matchmaking system for all sorts of events and dungeons and all that sort of stuff. So
so
that's kind of it. Before we go, our chat room says, well, Introspect from the chat room says that they've been playing Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic. Yay, KOTOR. I've been playing that on my tablet, on my iPad.
I've been hearing a resurgence about Knights of the Old Republic lately. Did it have a big sale, or did it get a relaunch or something like that?
There was a big announcement that it was on Android devices.
There you go.
Is that it?
But it sounds like Introspect is playing it on PC, trying to get the widescreen fix to work. I've been playing it on my tablet. It's okay on the tablet. It's a little tough to get over the control screen, the control scheme. So, but enjoyable. All right, I want to talk about our wonderful patrons. I love our patrons. They're fantastic.
Yes.
Really, really, absolutely love them. Especially since we hit $100. Woo! Yay! Woo-hoo! We've hit our first goal for Patreon, which is our if we stay up above 500 or 500 100 bi-monthly songs. So I actually I have a song here. I have our first song, which is going to be released. Are we ready, guys? Are we ready? Because it's awesome.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Here we go. Ready? Here we go.
You say if I let you die. all you have to do to make the rain, then you wouldn't be a noob, and you'd pew pew, cause you didn't wipe the group. What would you do if you did put that from me? More than words to show you get that you
There we go, ladies and gentlemen, the new song. I wrote that after a less than successful dungeon run when I was tanking.
So it's from
very
the heart.
Good.
It is very much from the heart.
So impressed that Harry can get that high.
No. Well, he is from Amsterdam.
Yeah.
you get it.
I got it. He lives far away.
I kind of put that on a tee for you, didn't I?
kind of did. Hope that you all enjoy that. That is our first song that we're releasing, having hit our goal for our Patreon campaign. You can check it out at patreon.com/MMOReporter. Our next goal is a patron-only podcast where we're going to have various hosts from the MMO Reporter Network talking about topics that are chosen. It's going to be a discussion-style show talking about topics picked by our patrons. So check that out. That is at $250. So go check it out, patreon.com/MMOReporter. We just had someone, I was going through the MMO Reporter swag closet today for one of our newest patrons who will be getting something from the swag closet. And I am going to PAX East, so I'll get some new stuff here too. If you want to check that out, I think it's a $25 pledge gets you the random item from the MMO Reporter swag closet. So hope you enjoyed that, everybody. I think it's time to move on to the news.
In the middle of the earth, in the land of Shire, lives a brave little hobbit whom we all admire. With his long windpipe, fuzzy woolly toes, lives in a hobbit hole and everybody knows him. Bilbo, Bilbo Baggins, Tommy Tinkin' Dog.
Yeah, that's a much cheerier song than the mood actually calls for. We sadly, as most of you probably already know, we lost Leonard Nimoy on February 27th. He passed away at the age of 83. And of course, Leonard Nimoy of Star Trek fame as Spock, also a smattering of other things, including our Bilbo Baggins song that we just played, which is actually a brilliant video. If you haven't seen it online, just search for Leonard Nimoy Bilbo Baggins and you'll find it. But anyway, it was sad to hear. I mean, Leonard Nimoy was 83 years old, but he was a very special, very awesome person in the sci-fi community. He was a geek before it was cool to be a geek, as many people are fond of saying. But
I do want to mention one thing before we get to the game thing, because I think it is important. He died from lung disease caused by his many, many years of smoking, as he was known to say in the last few years after he was diagnosed, don't smoke. He was very, very clear about what caused his heart failure caused by his smoking. So yeah, don't smoke. And if you do smoke, do your best to quit, because it causes very big issues. Anyways, moving on.
So considering that the influence that he's had on science fiction and general geekery over the last, we're getting on pretty much half a century now. A lot of MMOs out there, or space MMOs in particular, have started to plan tributes for Leonard Nimoy. Star Trek Online, the obvious contender, or obvious contributor, I should say, is going to be putting in a kind of a static Spock slash Leonard Nimoy memorial with their March 5th maintenance, which is going to be kind of a nice touch. So you can go in and see what they've set up for their for the event and the memorial space that they've set up. So that's kind of cool. Elite Dangerous is setting up a Nimoy Memorial Station in the Wings patch coming up, patch 1.2, which is the patch that introduces grouping to the game. So that'll be another spot to go visit in Elite Dangerous. Like there's a lot of people that are making pilgrimages to planet Earth, and also visiting the Voyager 2 satellite and Nimo Memorial Station, I think will just be another spot on kind of the tourist circuit in Elite Dangerous. So that's kind of cool. Star Citizen has said that they're going to be putting it something into the game to kind of commemorate Star Citizen, but we don't quite know yet. I imagine that'll come later. So that's basically what we've seen so far. Of course, every game, every any kind of science fiction, popular culture stuff has been putting out tweets and posts and that kind of thing, eulogizing Leonard Nimoy. So anyway, we haven't heard yet if World of Warcraft is going to do something in the same vein as Robin Williams. I would be more than a little surprised if they didn't, but we'll see. Actually, that's something that I've never really seen drop in World of Warcraft. You don't really see Star Trek references in there, and World of Warcraft has like pop culture references for almost everything. So anyway,
yeah,
we'll see what drops there. So anyway, I don't know. I just kind of wanted to have a little drop and a little chat about Leonard Nimoy. He's had such a neat personality as far as an actor goes. Like he always felt just a little bit more genuine. He was never cool, as in like just some of the kind of the smooth leading men out there, like maybe not even as cool as William Shatner, because I mean, how could you possibly be that cool? But I had a lot of respect for him, because he seemed to really embrace the fact that he was an intelligent person, but he wasn't snobby. He was very inclusive. He really embraced being Spock. Like, he went through a little phase where he really wanted to disassociate himself from the Spock character, but then he completely rebounded for that and completely, I felt like, especially through the 80s and 90s, he really kind of grabbed back onto it and said, yeah, I'm actually Spock, and really participated in the Star Trek community at conventions and obviously coming back. And I think from the original crew, or the original Star Trek crew, he's been in more Star Trek spin-offs, movies, everything than any of the other original actors. So he was a very cool person. So what's your guys's Leonard Nimoy impressions? What do you think of when you're thinking of Spock or Leonard Nimoy or the original Star Trek and that kind of thing?
When I think of Leonard Nimoy, I think of him as Spock, but I also think of him as the guy who taught me how to play Civilization 4. Because he was the narrator in that.
Yep.
Yeah, well, I'll go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think he's underrated for that too, because like he's not necessarily James Earl Jones, but he does have that very gravitas type voice to him that suited that as very well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for me, I think, I don't know, I liked sort of all the different things that he did. He was so many different parts. I mean, there's of course the original Transformers movie, and his role mm-hmm. in the new ones as well. Mm-hmm. Just his breadth of work. What I liked seeing was how many people who in many times would have been marginalized because of their love of science or geeky stuff, and seeing someone else who was an outcast portrayed in such a positive light, I think was just really cool.
And it's not even people who would have been marginalized. Let's not kid ourselves. Those were people that were marginalized. Like, he was one of the very few people. Like, when I say he was a celebrity for geeks before being a geek was cool, like, that's a serious thing. Like, that there it was, nobody really wanted to be the patron of the geeks back then. That had a stigma to it in society. So the fact that he was okay being an intelligent and embracing an intelligent man, an actor embracing the geekery that he's contributed to, I think is actually a really big deal, even more so than some of the geek models, role models that might be out there today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just want to move on before I cry. I'm kind of sad about it. He lived a very long life. He mm-hmm. Contributed in so many different positive ways, and I'm blubbering now.
Oh, well, just to see if we could finish you off here, I kind of wanted to finish this off with just his final tweet. It was kind of interesting. He had his son post it after he'd passed away, I guess, as he was determined he was going on. So his final tweet and his final message, just very Leonard Nimoy-ish, was a life is like a garden. Perfect moments can be had, but not preserved. Except in memory. Live long and prosper.
I can totally hear him saying that as well. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was impressed. So. Anyway, farewell, Leonard Nimoy.
Let's move things along, shall we?
Let's move things along. Yes, there's a little bit of Final Fantasy news, isn't there?
Yeah, there is. Final Fantasy XIV has reached 4 million registered players. This is reported over on Polygon. And this is purchased accounts, not subs. But Square did note that this does not take into account players who only signed up for free trials or anything like that. This is people who have plunked down money to buy the game, at the very least. Mm-hmm. So 4 million people. And to celebrate, they're actually having free game time until March 9th, which is going to, this upcoming Sunday. So it started last week
And that's free game time for everybody with a purchased account, even if it's lapsed?
It's a lapsed account time. So if you have purchased the game, but your account is not in good standing at this time, you can come back. I've been in there a couple times now. I've actually been playing Final Fantasy XIV, MMO Reporter's Game of the Year 2013, by the way. And it's not horrible. I'm not loving it yet, but it helps that I've been playing with Carrie. And just playing with somebody else, even if you don't love the game, it makes it a much better experience. And I'm playing it on PS4. She's playing it on PC, and it's working. Like, we're cross-servering like that. That is absolutely fantastic. Like, super cool.
Yeah. Oh, very cool. So,
yeah, it's that's really cool. I'm really impressed that it's continuing to do so. It's like the little Eve that could.
It's pretty rarefied company that they're getting into with 4 million people who have actually plunked down money for it. That's actually getting into downright successful territory. And when you consider the struggles that they went through to get past that original release phase, that was, I can't say firsthand, but from all reports and even Harry admitting it was pretty much an unmitigated disaster on release. Mm-hmm. To actually be able to come back and turn it into this solid game that's obviously a commercial success, but also becoming a critical success as well. I just love those redemption stories. It's nice to see that even when you're low and really low, there's still a path to success. I think there's probably a really happy, positive message there.
Pure, unadulterated stubbornness is what caused this. Yeah.
I have to say real quick that my sister, who has been playing World of Warcraft for 7 or 8 years now, has just switched over to Final Fantasy 14 2 months ago and said that she has completely quit World of Warcraft because Final Fantasy is actually bringing her into it deeper and deeper every time that she plays it.
Cool. Oh. That's awesome.
Very cool. That's really, and really cool. Like, yeah. Anyway, we've always said, the high tide raises all ships. So the better Final Fantasy does, the better it is for everyone, I think.
Go Final Fantasy 14. Mm-hmm. All right. Quick mention of our sponsors, GoDaddy. Use the coupon codes MMO149 to get your $1.49 domain, or MMO30 for your 30% off code order. Blah, blah. English words talk right order. Use the coupon code MMO30 to get 30% off your entire order. GoDaddy has been our sponsor for quite a while. They have also been our hosting provider for even longer, whether they are our sponsor or not. I really, really like their hosting. I think the prices are competitive, and they fix stuff when I break it very, very easily. Also, go check out Audible, audibletrial.com/MMOreporter, to get your free month, which means one free audiobook. The way it works, Audible, is you get a subscription to Audible, you get a credit a month, and you can use that credit to get an audiobook. It used to be that, you know, some books would take a couple credits, but no more. Everything that that you get is one credit. So every month you can get a book, no matter how many dozens and dozens of hours the book is. I can't even imagine one of the Wheel of Time or Game of Thrones books. I mean, that must be hours and hours.
It is. I actually re-listened. I tried to, when I did my last reread of Wheel of Time, I tried to do an actual reread, and I just I fizzled. So I actually got the audiobooks and read them that way, and it still took me weeks and weeks to get through of those.
Let's see
books.
How Eye of the World.
And sounds. Pardon me, that took me through to book 10, and then I actually read.
It will soon be time for the singing, and here all are welcome to take part. Ilyana, my love, we have a guest. Ilyana, where are you? The black-clad man's eyes widened, darted to the body of the golden-haired woman, then back to Luz Theron.
There you go. Take you. So there's a little, tease for you.
Yeah, the readers, I can't remember the name of the people they have reading them, but they're
Kate
very
Reading
very good.
And Michael Kramer. Mm. It is, this first book is 30 hours and 2 minutes for one book. Mm-hmm. One book. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean they're worth reading, they're good books, but it's almost the accomplishment of getting through it all is something I'm actually quite proud of, because that's, yes. Is it 14 books altogether that are all those monster 1,000-page?
And they're not done yet.
Oh, they are.
Oh, are they? I thought they had one more. They finished. Nope. Okay, don't tell me anything.
I would never.
Okay, good. Good man. And last but not least, you too can participate in Rambogo. Use the coupon code MMOReporter at Doghouse Systems to double your RAM. Now, they're going to be changing up the deal, so go check that out right now, because I know that they're changing things up soon, so we'll be letting you know about that pretty soon, where they're going to do something other than double your RAM. So if you're interested in that, go check it out now. Leonor, you have got the next story.
Yes, there were a few people that were talking about this on Twitter, and I thought it was a pretty interesting article. Black Desert recently announced that they have been making quite a bit of money during their closed beta when it was out for a little while. Now, Black Desert is a Korean MMO, which is supposed to be coming over to the United States and just over to the West in general at some point in time. But they've been testing it, and I think the game might even be out in Korea right now. But there were some crazy numbers that happened during this time. I'm kind of getting ahead of myself real quick.
A little bit.
From December 24th to December 31st, the cash shop in the game, mind you, this is where you buy pets and clothing and all kinds of other stuff, mainly cosmetic things. the money that was spent in the cash shop was $1.97 million. This is American dollars. It comes out to $2 billion some in Korean. And we were like, holy crap. Now, we took a look at some of the videos that the this one site put out with what the cash shop was. And they have these all these little cute pets. They have some armor and stuff. But it seems like the main thing that they have are bras and underwear.
I was going to say, this is it's a very cleverly disguised porn shop was what I kind of picked up from that.
Now, the game is absolutely beautiful, and the character work is just really cool. But, yeah, there's a lot of butts.
Wow.
I see what you did there. Let's just let that one percolate for a minute, eh?
Oh, but there is a slider that lets you make the clothing less revealing. But, yeah, no.
I just...
No, yeah. This is a lot of cash spent on these kinds Sorry. Of things just for, like a week. I mean, that's, like, a lot of money. What do you guys think? Do you think that when this game comes over here, do you think that all of the money that this game's going to make is mainly off of cosmetics? Or do you think that the game might actually be pretty good?
Well, considering I haven't seen anything about gameplay, just about the store. Whoa, there's mm-hmm. a guy in his underwear, and they're zooming into his package. Hello.
Yeah, it's I don't know.
He looks like Ron Perlman.
Yeah.
Just wait. It gets worse. There you go.
Yeah.
Oh, Dane Cook.
Anyway. I don't know. Again, MMOs doing well is great. I don't know. I mean, we've talked about hypersexualization in games and that kind of thing before, and it doesn't do it for me.
Okay. Sorry, Bill. It's right on that same topic, but this is, I don't understand why this is necessary at all, but I mean, with the video that I'm showing the live chat, there's some jiggling that really doesn't need to happen. I mean, I understand realism and stuff like that, but that's not realism. I mean, this is just no. Like, I don't think I'm going to be able to play this game because I find this sort of stuff not cool. And sorry, Bill, I totally interrupted you. Go ahead. I was just
I'm pretty much on the same page. It's
cool.
I hate to sound like the old man, but it's distasteful, and it's I mean, really, if there's 1,000 places on the internet to look for that kind of thing, I don't need it in my games. Right?
Yeah.
More than 1,000, actually. That was a very low estimate.
And here's the thing. You could... unfortunately, to me, my first thought is, oh, the gameplay must suck if they have to do that. That's my first thought. When they hypersexualize, when there's the skimpy clothing, and every game that I've played that has that, the gameplay is lacking, and they're compensating, like stuffing a sock down your pants.
See, I don't even go that far. I think I'm disappointed. Like, oh, if it was a good game, I'll probably never know because I'm just completely turned off now.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm. You said it, Bill. I don't need to say anything else. Leonor, are we being grumpy old men?
Possibly. I like it.
Oh, good.
I think it is kind of nice to see a little bit of realism, even though people do not jiggle that way. It's mostly fantasy with realism. You know what I mean?
Right. Ken from Chicago says, just like Bill did, if you want porn, there's porn online. If your game needs to go there, there's a problem.
Yeah, and I don't want to come off as saying that this shouldn't exist, and I don't want to come off as saying that developers should be embarrassed and they should have never done this or anything like that. That's not what I'm saying at all. I realize that this is exactly some people's thing. It's just really, really not for me.
But is it also partially North America's prudeness towards nudity and sexuality?
I
It could be a cultural thing.
It's possibly in there. I don't know. It just seems so...
And I'm going to generalize... go ahead.
It's so over the top that I think that there's... It can't be exclusively North American prudishness towards body parts and that kind of thing.
But here's there's
a little bit of gaucheness to the game as well.
Here's the thing, though. If you look at games that tend to come out of Asia, they tend to have the bra and panty cosmetics that you can buy. Aeon, Terra, Final Fantasy a little bit, although Final Fantasy is a little bit different. It has a little bit of that. This game, Lineage, right? This is a cultural norm there.
Is it?
In every game not every game. In
all
most
the games that he has said,
games,
it does have it.
Right? And those are, like, let's name some other big Asian MMOs that have come out. There we go. Right? That's pretty much the list right there. I know there's others. We know there's others. But, you know, those are the big ones that came to North America from Asia. And they all have that. So is it is it just different culture? And this is, you know, this sort of stuff is just part of the culture there. And is it, yeah, anyways. Anyways, grumpy old men.
Sorry.
I'm allowed to be grumpy. I am an old man now.
I don't like being the grumpy old man, but I think I'm going to be this time.
Get off our virtual lawn. Put on some clothes while you're at it.
Hmm. Bundle up. Don't you know it's winter?
Yeah. Sorry.
Pull up your pants.
Anything else you want to add about Black Desert? The character models look awesome. And when there's actual armor and stuff, it looks good. But, yeah.
Nope. You guys hit pretty much every point. I just wanted to point out, would you guys play a game just for these options in the cash shop?
If it wasn't...
Absolutely. That would drive me away rather than draw me.
Yeah, if they had more, like if they had tons and tons of options that were not quite so hypersexualizing, yes, absolutely, to steal Bill's term. I'm just throwing a little bit of actual gameplay from the game in here so that we can see that.
Right.
Chat room says Arcage, but Arcage also has some as well. But they're a little bit different because they weren't just localized, and the term localizing means just changing everything to the language. The game was actually in development at Tryon for a while to be westernized. Same thing that they tried to do with Terra, but I think Arcage did a little bit better job of just changing more of the game to be western. Anyways, sorry, Leonor, I'm still cutting you off again and again. That's just what I do because I'm a jerk.
No, I ended it twice.
Okay. Good. Moving on then. Quick mention. I think at least I'm really starting to get interested about Crowfall, which is, of course, the persistent character dying worlds MMO. It has surpassed its Kickstarter goal of 800,000 and is now nearly at 1,951,000. Lots to like about what they've been talking about with this game. Now the goal of the developer is to deliver on this implied promise that a Kickstarter has. So hopefully this is one of the success stories. You know, you look at Star Citizen, I'd call that almost a success story. They've still only released chunks, but...
Yeah, they did okay.
It's going along far enough that I think we can call that a success. I hope this follows that trend, not the one that we talked about last week, which is...
Well, there is a couple of big things about this. There was the this was Kickstarter's number one dev pick for like the week. Felicia Day just last week said that she is backing this game, you know, to put money in for it to help kickstart it. So there's a lot of talk about this game.
Yeah, I think I really hope that the execution matches the vision, for lack of a better term. Introspect is asking about the repopulation in the chat room here. This is the first PAX in a few years where the developer hasn't contacted me for an interview. I don't know if he's going to PAX East this year. We've got a few videos on our YouTube page about the repopulation. It's just about getting some more news. They're still quite deep in beta. So they did that, and they did early access as well. So, yeah, there's lots to like about the repopulation. I can't wait till the next time I actually get to try it, which the last time was not. I didn't get a playable demo. All right, let's move things along. Bill, if people want to contact us, how would they do that?
Well, they can head over to mmoreporter.com to find the central hub of the MMO Reporter universe, so including MMO Reporter information everywhere, including all our brother and sister podcasts and all that kind of wonderful stuff. They can send us an email to mmo.reporter@gmail.com. They can check us out on Facebook, facebook.com/mmoreporter. They can tweet at any of the MMO reporters, including at MMO Bill for yours truly, at Leonor for Leonor, at Harry Hall for Harry Hall, and at MMO_reporter for Master Chris. Give us a call at 616-666-6778 and leave us a voicemail there. We would love to play it on the show. Sans swears. Actually, you know what? Even if there are swears, we'll probably play a couple of swears. Just saying.
I'll just go beep.
Visit our Yeah. Or visit our YouTube channel, youtube.com/user/MMO Reporter Network. You're killing my vibe there, Chris. Thanks so much. I appreciate it. I love you like a brother. And finally, head over to mmoreporter.com/support. Only one slash. I said it twice because it's important. To find out the various ways that you can actually support the MMO Reporter Network, including patreon.com/MMO Reporter, where we love all of our patrons that bumped us over that $100 mark to get us a new Harry Hall and Chris song special.
Sorry, I'm chatting to the chat room. It's been a long time since I've been distracted by the chat room. Yeah, they're talking about the fact that we are MMO_reporter. @MMO Reporter was taken by someone who never, ever, ever uses the account. I am sad.
They had it before. To be fair, they had it before we were ever MMO Reporter. Like,
no, right around. Well, yes, they did. Yeah, they had it.
Yes, we looked for it instantly when we decided we were going to call the show MMO Reporter, and it was there.
Yeah.
So.
And they are. They have not used their account since 2010.
May 7th, 2010.
I'm surprised you guys didn't call the show MMO Canadians.
Are you really?
That's a good idea. Write that down. I like that.
That's a new show, MMO Canadians.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a thing.
I'll work on the logo.
Yeah.
Just put
syrup and mousse and
yep.
I don't know what else. Like I'm looking at our MMO Reporter backdrop here.
Tim Horton's cup rolled up. Rolled up.
Some hockey sticks. Yeah.
We got to apologize for it somehow too. You can put like a little disclaimer that says sorry if we forgot anything.
Sorry. All right.
Can we put Sarah Palin in there?
Thank you.
No, I'm not even I'm not going to apologize for that.
That's your damn fault. For another fantastic show.
You are welcome, sir.
And thanks, Bill. As always, another great show.
My pleasure.
Thanks to everyone in the chat room. We had fun tonight hanging out with all those people. Hope you enjoyed the new song that we put out there for you tonight. And hope that you enjoyed the podcast. We hope that you download it again next week. But most importantly, we hope to see you in game.
Don't forget about your alts you need to cherish. Each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at. Don't forget about your alts you need to cherish. Each and every little character you've got, no matter what level they're at.
Weird, it was buffering. Show was buffering. Thanks for watching the video, everybody. Don't forget to check out all the other podcasts at mmoreporter.com or by clicking on any of the links here. And please check out our Patreon campaign at patreon.com/mmoreporter. Thanks, everyone, and see you in game.